We're actually from mainland China here. 来自大陆的有多？哇！From mainland, 来自大陆的这么多吗? Wow. So it's a real privilege to come and share with you. This is an amazing international church. But one of the things about China, there's a saying about China that everything you hear, you might have heard this before maybe, if Peter's been your pastor, but everything you hear about China is both true and false at the same time. I don't know if that makes sense. So is there a massive, incredible revival happening in China? Yes. Are there parts of China which are completely unreached? Yes. And so my heart is always, actually, I didn't come to China to help the Chinese church. I read books like about Brother Yun and all these people and the amazing revivals in China's church, and I think it's better than the British church. But then I realized that there was many minority groups in West China particularly, both in the Southwest and the Northwest, who really are completely unreached still. And I'm basically focusing particularly on Muslim minority peoples. Actually, China has, out of the 55 official minorities in China, 10 are Muslim. Some people don't even know there are Muslims in China. There are more Muslims in China than I think in Saudi Arabia. 20 million or more is a conservative estimate. And a number of those groups, I would say, are completely unreached with the gospel. So it's exciting as a foreigner I can be working, but also it's encouraging the Chinese house church as well, just really trying to work and push into all these areas. And so this morning, of course, I really have to talk about mission because it's something that's really on my heart and it's exciting for me. But I want to talk about mission in general, not necessarily China. And I want to use the passage we just read is when Jesus talks about, he tells his disciples that when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you will receive power and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And hopefully today will be quite simple, but I want to use these four places that he mentions. He mentions four specific places: Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth. And it's often been said that Luke, let's go back quickly actually. It's often been said that Luke chapter 1, verse 8 is a kind of key text for the whole book of Acts. Sorry, Luke wrote Acts, sorry. Acts chapter 1, verse 8 is a key text for the whole book of Acts. And the rest of the book is simply Luke describing the gospel going from Jerusalem through Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Very roughly, chapters 2 to 7 of Acts talk about the gospel's progress in Jerusalem. Chapter 8 talks about the gospel's progress in Judea and Samaria. And chapters 9 through 28 talk about the gospel's progress to the ends of the earth. And there's one important thing I think we need to understand to understand the flow of Acts and how Acts unfolds. And that's simply this. For Luke, who wrote Acts, in his mindset, in his worldview, Rome signifies the ends of the earth. Now, it's not literally the ends of the earth. New Zealand is. Just kidding. Depends where you put the map. In England, we put Europe in the middle. Sort of America's on from my point of view, this side, and China's on that side. I get to China, and I find China's in the middle. And then you go to America. But that's okay, because the Pacific Ocean's big, and so kind of both can work. But the most illogical is the United States. They put themselves in the middle, and then the rest of it's ocean, and the rest of the whole world's squeezed to the side. But anyway, I'm being British, of course, we're correct. But if you put Jerusalem in the middle, New Zealand's pretty much near the ends of the earth, right? So in a sense, the gospel's got to the ends of the earth, but I'll talk about that later. But the ends of the earth, actually, the definition has changed. And the ends of the earth is not so much getting a ruler and measuring how far it is from Jerusalem, it's more who are the unreached peoples of the world. But we'll get to that. Where was I? Yeah. So for Luke, Rome signifies the ends of the earth. Why? Because it's the great capital of the Roman pagan empire. So the gospel's gone from the city representing the people of God, Jerusalem, and it gets to Rome, which represents the Gentile world. And that's why I think Luke ends in a kind of... Shall I turn this one off and use this one? Is it too booming? Yeah, let's try that. Is that better? Okay. I'll just move away from this camera, from this phone.
So that's why I think the gospel, that's why Acts ends where it does. Have you ever noticed when you read the end of Acts, do you know what happens at the end of Acts? Anyone know? How does Acts finish? It finishes with Paul in Rome, right? But it's a very ambiguous ending. He just preaches for 2 years in Rome. It just says for 2 years, he welcomed people and he preached. And I always want to know, okay, Luke, thank you, but what happened next? It begs the question. So what happened next? It's tantalizing. 2 years he preaches. What happens next? And there's, of course, there's many traditions, and there's even a tradition that he was probably released, possibly. He possibly was executed, or he was released. Tradition relates he was released. There's even a traditional, an apocryphal, outside the Bible kind of book, which suggests that he even went to Britain. I think it's more about the British ego or wanting to feel good about ourselves. We also have a story about Jesus coming to Britain, but him about that, let's not go there. However historical or unhistorical those things may be, for Luke, it's not important. Actually, Luke's not writing a biography of Peter, for the first part, or Paul. Luke is simply telling us that God's purposes prevail, and look, Jesus said the gospel's going from Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth, and hey, the gospel's got to the ends of the earth. God is sovereign. His purposes are working out through Peter, through Paul, through whoever. So Luke doesn't need to tell us exactly what happened in the end of Paul's life. The point for him is the gospel has got to Rome. And so simply I want to use this model as a kind of a basis for what I see mission going, how mission should be, I believe, today, or the scope of mission today. And specifically, Jerusalem stands for local mission. Judea stands for regional mission, Samaria stands for cross-cultural mission, and the ends of the earth stands for global mission. And I want to quickly go through, because I tend to talk long, so I'll try and be quick, to go through each category. No, let's not go there at all. Okay. So we'll start with Jerusalem. Now, is the capital, is the spiritual center of Judaism. And it's where the climax of Jesus' ministry took place and where his death and resurrection took place. It could be described as Christianity's initial kind of hometown. And the most important thing is Jesus does not tell his disciples just to forget about Jerusalem, just go somewhere else. He actually tells them specifically to start in Jerusalem. And we see two very important things happening in the early chapters of Acts. Firstly, it says the gospel spread we see the gospel spreading rapidly among the residents of the city itself, among the residents of Jerusalem. In Acts chapter 5, the apostles were accused by the Sanhedrin of filling Jerusalem with their teaching. That's a great accusation. I'd like that one. I wouldn't like the punishment they had afterwards, maybe. But imagine if the government of Auckland had to come and go, guys, can you calm down because you're filling Auckland with your teaching. So the first thing of mission is the people around us, the people that we've been in our workplaces, in our families, in our schools and universities, the people around us, they're our mission field. That's the basis for every mission. All mission is where am I now? Where has God put me now? And so the first thing we need to be doing is reaching out to the people around us. If we're thinking about mission, but we need to first get that in place. But there's a second very interesting thing that happened in Acts chapter 2. As we all know, on the first Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came, Pentecost was another feast, Passover was the feast, and 50 days later was Pentecost. And that feast, of course, we had many Jews visiting Jerusalem from all over the known world. And they were able to hear the gospel, or hear Peter's speech, or they heard people speaking in tongues. These people came from all over the world, and they were able to take the gospel, we presume, back to all these places in Acts chapter 2. If you get a chance, read that again. Read Acts chapter 2. And this, I believe, can be a role also of a city like Auckland. Now we're having people from all over the world coming to this city, and this is an incredible opportunity, particularly Western cities, which are more and more increasingly multicultural. We have an opportunity to preach the gospel to people who come here for short or a medium term, and they can take the gospel back to their own countries, which may well be a closed country or a country where it's hard to preach the gospel. I think this specifically applies to students and professionals. I'm going to talk about other types of multiculturalism later. But I think the Jerusalem ministry specifically applies to students and professionals who come individually, perhaps as families, for a short period of time or a medium period of time, for a few years. What an opportunity to share the gospel with them and so they can take it back to their own places. So I believe Jerusalem ministry has two aspects. One is reaching the people, the residents of the city, and the second is reaching those who come for periods of time that they can take the gospel back. Of course, we shouldn't just be thinking about those coming from afar, though. We should also be thinking about those in the regions around, which brings me to the second category, which is Judea, regional ministry. Now, Judea was the Jewish region around Jerusalem. It was the area inherited from Judah. Now, if you remember, the kingdom of Israel split in the 10th century BC under Solomon's son. He wasn't very wise, unlike his father. He wasn't very wise, and he lost the northern kingdom. So most of the tribes went to the north and became what we call Israel, what was called Israel. The southern tribe was Judah. But actually, Judah was where Jerusalem was, it was where the temple was, and it was where the traditions of Israel sort of solidified, and of course it was where the king was, the Davidic line, the line of David. They were all in Judah, and Israel didn't do very well and was actually destroyed by the Assyrians in 722 BC. Judah lasted a bit longer, and it was eventually exiled by the Babylonians. But what you notice in the Bible, when you look at the Bible in the Old Testament, you see a lot about Israelites. But as you get towards the exile period and afterwards, and by the time of the New Testament, the word evolves from Israelites to Jews. Notice that? We move kind of from the Israelites. You don't read much about Jews in the first few books of the Bible. It's not really a concept. But Jews is inherited from Judah, and they kept the traditions of Israel. And so we have Jews, Judaism, and Judea. Judea was the Roman word for Judah. And so this kind of area saw itself as the real true worshippers of Yahweh, the real kosher, if you like, Jews, the proper people of God. Now, it was culturally very similar to Jerusalem, and it was easy. There was no cultural gap between the gospel going from Jerusalem out to Judea. But very interestingly, if you notice in Acts, when do we record the gospel going to Judea? Quite late. Acts chapter 1 to 7 was all about Jerusalem. It seemed to almost need the persecution of Stephen in Acts chapter 7. Remember Stephen's stoned, right? And then there's a big persecution that takes place in Acts chapter 8. And then it says all the disciples, except the apostles, were scattered, and they went and preached the gospel wherever they went, to Judea and Samaria. So even though Jesus had clearly said Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, it kind of needed some kind of, God needed to do something there, I think. And then they scattered, and the gospel went to Judea. Now today we face a very different situation, but I think it's often the case that the big cities, I don't know so much about Auckland, but I think sometimes like London, the big cities can attract, they have the lively churches, they attract the big people of talent. And the traffic can often be sort of one way. We like the sort of cities and the places where there's a lot of resources. And the challenge, I think, is for big, lively churches in the cities to really be reaching out, to partnering with local churches in the countryside around or in the small towns and villages, which perhaps have less resources. And I also want to add one challenge to the church here, because it's a very international church, so many Chinese friends, and I think Japanese and Koreans and other friends. Another aspect of what I think Judean ministry how it relates to the West, I would sometimes think the Judeans are very similar, maybe there's some parallel between them and the Caucasian white people. Now, the Jews had all the blessings of God. Paul writes about this in Romans 9 to 10. The Jews had all the blessings of God. They had all the covenants, the promises, they had the Messiah, and yet they rejected Jesus. But Paul had a heart to reach the Jewish people. He said, God hasn't forgotten them, he wants to reach them. I think there's an interesting parallel between them and the Europeans, or what we'd say Caucasians. We've had all the blessings of God. We've spent the last 200 years reaching out to the whole world and taking the gospel everywhere. But what's happened in those 200 years? The same thing. At the same time, Western culture has become increasingly secularized. It's incredible. 1789, what happened? 1789. French Revolution. I think that was a big major turning, the starting point of 200 years of secularization. Secularization, 世俗化, right? The world just going slowly against God. What happened in 1793? William Carey got on a ship and sailed to India. No one's heard of that. Okay, who's heard of William Carey? William Carey was a missionary to India, but he's known as the father of modern missions. And so he basically, when he sailed to India, Protestant missions, there's actually been Catholic missions before that, but he's known as the father of modern Protestant missions, and he started this incredible movement for 200 years, or 150 years, of the Western nations taking the gospel all over the world. Incredible. Two things happening at the same time. The Western nations have gone all the world and blessed the world with the gospel. Did some bad things as well. Let's not talk about that. Talking about the gospel. At the same time, the Western world increasingly rejects the gospel. The Jews, the apostles, in Jesus' time, the apostles, Paul and the others, Jewish people, the first believers were all Jews. They went out blessing the world with the gospel. At the same time, the Jewish people rejected the gospel. But God had a heart for the Jewish. God has a heart. Paul also writes in Romans 9-11, he has a heart for the Jewish people. And I really believe I believe God has a heart for the average Kiwi who doesn't know anything about the Bible, about Christianity now. Mike was saying to me yesterday, average Western, average Kiwi is becoming increasingly biblically illiterate. They don't even know the facts anymore. They don't know anything anymore. In Mike's day, he was saying, in Mike's day, just kidding. He was saying we had some kind of, at least they had some knowledge. Now the average white person growing up in our towns and cities doesn't know anything. Maybe America's an exception, actually. America's bucking the trend. But I would say Canada, the US, New Zealand, Australia, and Europe, much of Europe, increasingly are illiterate. My challenge for you guys, as international people who've had, or international who've come here, experience the blessings of the how the gospel has impacted Western culture. All the blessings that have come from Western culture, which have come from the gospel, and which we're quite happily throwing away, as Westerners. My challenge for you is, do you have a heart for the Judean white people, the Kiwis, the average guy on the street in your area who has no idea about the gospel? And I think, I sometimes say to Chinese friends, come to the UK. If you share the gospel with British people, maybe they'll listen. If I share it, they'll think, nah, you know, it's old, it's out of date, who cares, I don't want your religion. But what if the Chinese and Korean friends and African friends come to the UK and share it? I think that's an amazing opportunity. So just to add that, I think specifically Judean ministry could also include just the average Kiwi bloke on the street. Okay, so, but generally regional ministry. So I guess in sum, the challenge of a big church in the city is to be engaging with the people around us, and the people in the villages and towns who maybe don't have such great resources, and also perhaps just the average guy on the street. But we shouldn't just be thinking about Caucasians. Actually, of course, you also have indigenous peoples here, and of course we know that our cities in the West are increased, and our nations in the West are increasingly cross-cultural. Which brings me to the third category, Samaritan ministry. Now, Samaria was the central area of Israel. It was based between Judea in the south and Galilee in the north, so it's kind of the middle part. Now, this area had formed part of the northern kingdom when I talked about it earlier, that the Israel had split between the north and the south. So this was part of the northern kingdom. And it was destroyed by the Assyrians in 722 BC. The area was subsequently resettled. And crucially, they did become worshippers of Yahweh again, of God again. They were worshippers of God. But they only recognized the first five books of the Bible. They didn't recognize the later books. They only recognized the books of Moses. Why? Anyone know why? Because, of course, the later books all emphasize Jerusalem. They emphasize, well, this is my opinion, they emphasize Jerusalem, they emphasize the line of David, the Davidic king, the southern king, they emphasize the temple, and they emphasize all the things that the Jews thought were the important things. The Samaritans were like, no, we worship God on this mountain. Remember the story of Jesus and the Samaritan woman? He said, we worship on this mountain and you worship in Jerusalem. Remember that? What's the mountain she's talking about? Gerizim. Good. She's talking about Mount Gerizim. Mount Gerizim was the mountain in Deuteronomy where God had told, when Moses had told the tribes to stand and bless the people. That was the mountain the Samaritans believed we should worship God. And so there was a lot of animosity between Jews and Samaritans. They both worshipped the one God, and as we know in history, worshipping the same God has not stopped people from fighting each other. Notice that? We're not very good at getting on with each other, are we? And the Jews and Samaritans worshipped the same God, but they very much disliked each other. And of course, Jesus said to the woman, what did he say? It's not about that mountain or Jerusalem. It's about spirit and in truth. And Jesus came to break down all these barriers that we see. He came to break down the barrier of ethnic barriers and religious barriers. But by the time of Jesus, there was this strong mutual distrust between Jews and Samaritans. And so I've heard it said that if a Jew is down in Judea and he wants to go to Galilee, he'd go to the border of Samaria, go all the way along the side, go up the river and all the way round, just so he wouldn't have to go through Samaria. That was the kind of attitude they had. Now, Jesus went through Samaria twice, that we know of. One time he was welcomed, and we saw that story with the Samaritan woman. He's welcomed, and people listen to him. The other time he wasn't welcomed. Luke chapter 9, he was going to Jerusalem, and he had to go through Samaria, and the people didn't welcome him. Why not? Because he was going to Jerusalem. So if he's someone big saying, I'm going to be your savior, but I'm going to Jerusalem, they're saying, okay, well, you're recognizing the Jews, you're recognizing Jerusalem, you're recognizing the temple, you're recognizing all the stuff that we don't think is important. So they didn't recognize him. And James and John said, can we call down fire on these people? And Jesus rebuked them because it's not his way. Jesus came to break down the barrier between Jew and Samaritan. And Paul writes very clearly, in Christ there's no Jew or Greek, male or female, slave or free. The three major categories of the ancient world. Are you a man or a woman? Are you a slave or a free? Or from a religious perspective, are you a Jew or a Greek or a Gentile? Jew or a Gentile? And Paul says in Christ, it's irrelevant. What's relevant is Jesus. So we need to be crossing these cultural barriers. There's a good example of a Jew and a Samaritan situation where I'm based in China between what we call the Han majority. The Han are the sort of majority Chinese, and the Hui minority. Hui, and Chinese friends will know, the Hui is basically the Muslims in China. So there's a Han-Hui thing. And I'm going to talk about there are Hui all over China, but I'm talking about particularly the region where I live, Ganxingning, central northwest China. Now in this area, there's a lot of tension between the Han and the Hui. Cultural barriers, religious barriers over the centuries, some bad historical baggage, a lot of really bad fighting happened between Han and Hui. And the Chinese government actually does a really good job to promote ethnic harmony. Put my hand up for the Chinese government for a minute. I'm on a government scholarship. I love the Chinese government, nothing against them. And they do a really good job at promoting Han and Hui harmony. That's absolutely true. Since the opening up reform, Gaigai Kaifang Yilai, 1978 up till now, there's been really good relationships. But there's underlying tensions between Han and Hui. Underlying, there's always this tension. The Hui think the Han are quite, they look down on the Han because of their eating habits. They eat pork and all these things that you shouldn't eat as a Muslim, so they think they don't eat well. But the Han think you can't trust the Hui. Now the Han will have a phrase like, Hui Hui de fan ke yi shi, Hui Hui de hua bu nang ting. You can eat the Hui Hui's food, but you can't believe the Hui Hui's speech. Okay, and that's just these are stereotypes that we have of each other. But okay, and I can waste all your time this morning talking about the Han and the Hui. But what's my point? My point is this is a problem for the gospel. This is a problem for the gospel. Because when the gospel spreads among the Han, it's fine. It gets to a Hui person, even if they're not particularly religious. Now, the Hui in my area are quite religious, but some of them still are not that bothered about it. But because you're a Han, it's a Han thing, I'm not interested. Okay, and so the question is, how do we encourage the Han to cross that barrier to the Hui? I was sharing with a house church about the need to reach Hui with the gospel. And one of the Chinese ladies in the class, house church lady, dear lady, she said to me, "但是回族是坏人." But the Hui are bad people. I'm thinking, reminds me of something like the gospel. I've heard something before. We were sinners and Christ died for us. Isn't this the point of the gospel? We're bad people. Anyone here is not a bad person, doesn't need Jesus, put your hand up. You could leave straight away and go and play golf. Okay? It's why we were sinners that Christ died for us. We were enemies of God. We were reconciled to God through the death of his son. You who were once far away were brought near through the blood of Christ. And our basic response, surely, should be we should offer that grace to others, even if we don't like them in the natural. Actually, I don't blame this woman at all. And she's being honest. It's honesty, isn't it? She's being honest. That's her real situation. And I sometimes struggle with Muslim culture. I find Han cultures more relaxing, and Tibetan culture. I like the other cultures. Sometimes I say to God, I like all these other cultures, but I'm pressing in with Muslims because I believe God's called me to work with Muslims. And it's not about my love. It's about God's love. For it's Christ's love that compels us. For we're convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. So we don't have to like people. We need to love people, not necessarily like them. So let's bring that back to this area, in Auckland maybe. The challenge of Samaritan ministry as opposed to Judean ministry is it's cross-cultural. Sometimes we need to get out of our comfort zone, we need to overcome our prejudices, and try and engage people on their own cultural terms. Maybe you have to overcome kind of cultural barriers to reach people. I've been living with some Muslim families, and one thing I did, the first time I was living with a Muslim family in the countryside, I'd been there for 2 weeks, I'm sitting around, we're having dinner, and I'm eating the bread, the momo, and we'll say, momo cha, always taking, eat bread, drink tea. Anyway, I'm eating my bread, and one guy's looking at me, and one of the guys in the family suddenly looks at me pretty fiercely. And I'm wondering, is he going to ask me some question about my research? And he says to me, can you not eat the bread like that, please, anymore? I said, what do you mean? He says, you're taking the bread like that, you're not respecting the bread, and that's not the way God has us eating bread. You should break the bread before you eat it. I was like, bai kai nega mimba and momo, and then eat it. I was like, wow, I didn't know. I'm really sorry. I really didn't know that. So now, in all conscience as a Christian, I've reflected on this point a lot. In all conscience as a Christian, I think I can come to God with a clear conscience and eat bread like that. I struggle with a lot of issues, but that's not one of them. But for him, it's important. And for Muslims, it's incredibly important. So now, every time I'm with Muslims, I make sure I break the bread first and eat it. Don't eat it like a sandwich. Eat it like that. It's a small issue. But the point is, it's a small issue for me, but it's not a small issue for him. That's how you eat bread. And then again, the hand probably don't do it right, you know? It's another example where the Muslim, this is how you do things properly. And so the challenge really is, how can we kind of be reaching out, reaching across to these cultural divides? Auckland is a melting pot of peoples, as we know. Mike tells me it's the most multicultural city in the world. Well, he's wrong. That's clearly London. But maybe it's number two. I don't know if it is. Actually, I don't know. I've got no idea. But all the Western cities in the world are clearly incredibly multicultural. I think we can split this multiculturalism into two categories. The first category will be professionals and students coming from all over the world to work or study for short or long periods. And I've already covered them under Jerusalem ministry. That's a bit easier, actually, because they're coming from a culture individually or in groups. They're coming from their culture, and they're engaging with Kiwi culture or international culture. And they're open to new ideas. But there's a second category, which I think we need to also engage with, and that is the migrant communities. Communities of people coming who've settled, in generations maybe, but they're creating a little bit of that culture in Auckland, in London, in these places. In London, we have the Turkish community, I think, the Bangladeshis. We have many, many peoples in these places. And they're not just coming as individuals and say, I'm a student, I'm open to stuff. They're coming and bringing their own culture. That, to me, is what the Samaritan ministry relates to, I think, in our modern day. It's engaging with these particular areas and cultural groups we find in our Western cities. Today we're seeing immigration on a massive, unprecedented scale. It's incredible what's happening. And there's all these arguments on TV. You see all the arguments, is it good or is it bad? What are the challenges? What are the opportunities? But as Christians, I think we need to step back from the usual debates. And I say this to myself as much as anyone else. We've all got our opinions. And in Europe, the migration crisis is a very important issue at the moment. And say, but the more important question always is, what is God doing? What's he doing? In Habakkuk, God says to Habakkuk, look at the nations and be amazed. Watch, I am doing something in your day you would not believe even if you were told. And actually he's going to send the Babylonians. And Habakkuk's not very happy with what he's going to do, but he changed that. He was shaking the world. God's doing that today. He's bringing people from all places to the Western nations. And I think he's using it for his purposes. Some or many of the peoples who come here from these nations are maybe from closed nations which do not have a chance to hear the gospel, or it's very hard to preach the gospel. And God's bringing all these peoples here. So the challenge for us, I believe, in big cities in the West is, are we taking these cross-cultural Samaritan opportunities to reach the peoples from all over the world, perhaps from Muslim countries and other countries, who have very little chance to hear the gospel? Now they do. Now they're in a free, open society for now, and they do have a chance to hear the gospel. So let's take these opportunities to reach the Samaritan communities among us, the cross-cultural communities that are increasing in our big cities and regions in the West due to immigration. And as we reach these people, I believe we're not only blessing them and their families, but we're also, through them and their connections with their countries of origin, we're touching the ends of the earth. Which brings me to the final category, which is the ends of the earth. Now, global mission has been a passion of mine since I did a course called Perspectives on World Mission after I graduated from high school. And actually, that's a very similar course to, I think, what Anna's running. Is that right? The Kairos course. So I want to reiterate that. Really, if you're interested in this, please sign up for that Kairos course in Mandarin or in English. Well, if you can't speak Mandarin, just do it in English, okay? But please sign up for the course, because I think that course just radically transformed my life. After that course, I was like, right, I want to just be involved in reaching the unreached peoples of the world. A few years later, I was praying through this book called Operation World. Operation World is a book which relates all the countries in the world and all the gospel situation, the gospel situation in all the countries in the world. I prayed through the whole book through the whole year, and during that year, two people groups just jumped right out of me. Out of the whole year, just one day, two people groups jumped at me, and there were two people groups in central northwest China, Bao'anzu and Salazu, the Bao'an people and the Salar people. Now, these two peoples I want to talk about more later. I haven't got time to talk about them so much, but on Tuesday evening, I'm going to share at William Carey Baptist. Carey Baptist Church. Carey Baptist College in Penrose. And that's, if you're interested, people here know about this, right? Okay, so please speak to people. Murray's probably the main man to speak to about that. Okay, if you're interested, and Mike as well. But we're going to be sharing about people groups of Southwest China, Northwest China. And so if you're interested in these people groups and the need in China, please come along to that. But today I want to quickly talk in principle about the idea of an unreached people group. Because I think there's a lot of misunderstanding about mission and the need for mission today. If you take the 195 countries of the world, roughly, depending on your definition, there are 195 countries in the world. Do all these countries probably have some Christians in them? Probably yes, right? Most of them do. Maybe the Maldives, I'm not sure. Maybe a few countries don't, but most countries in the world have Christians in them. Does that mean the countries are all reached with the gospel? No, it doesn't. In the New Testament, the Greek word ethne is the Greek word, often in English translated as nation. But actually, the word ethne is much more similar to what we would think of as ethnicity and ethnic group, which of course is where the words come from. Ethne, you get ethnic group, ethnicity, than the modern word of a nation state. The modern nation state was created by Europeans post-Enlightenment, traveling around the world and drawing lines in the sand. I apologize for that now. We went around the whole world drawing lines in the sand, defining nation states. Sometimes pretty unrelated to how the people themselves viewed their connections. And so I think this idea of an ethne, we shouldn't be thinking about countries in the world. Has China got millions and millions of Christians, more Christians than British people? Yes. Is China reached? No. Completely? No. Jesus tells us in Matthew 28 to go and make disciples of all ethne, all nations. In Revelation 7, chapter 7, John sees has a picture of the redeemed people of God standing before the throne, from every nation, ethnos, same root, every nation, tribe, people, and language. So we need to be thinking about tribes, peoples, languages, nation, and ethnic groups. And bringing these ideas together, mission agencies like to talk about the idea of a people group. A people group. Now, what is a people group? According to Joshua Project, which is an organization focusing on the least reached peoples, a people group is this: a significantly large grouping of people, of individuals, who perceive themselves to have a common affinity with one another. Now, this is crucial. For evangelization purposes, a people group is the largest group within which the gospel can spread as a church-planting movement without encountering barriers of understanding or acceptance. So if the gospel can keep going and not stop, then that's kind of where you're looking at with a people group. And there's two things that can happen: understanding or acceptance. Is there a light here? Yeah. Understanding or acceptance. Understanding could be linguistic, but acceptance could be exactly what I'm talking about with the Han and the Hui, or even the Jews and Samaritans. Jesus had no problem communicating with Samaritans. We know that, right? They probably both spoke Aramaic, I think. Han have no problem communicating with Hui. But there's no barrier of understanding. There's too much understanding. Sorry, I'm just kidding. But there's barriers of acceptance. And so we need to think about people groups of in that sense. The next thing we need to think about is, what's an unreached people group? What does it mean for a people group to be unreached? And the same the website also says this: an unreached people group is a people group among which there is no indigenous community of believing Christians with adequate numbers and resources to evangelize this people group without outside assistance. Note, very important, it does not say there are no Christians or no believers in the group. It doesn't say that. What it says is that these believers are so few in number that they do not have the resources to reach their own people. Bao Anzu, the Bonan people, I know of 2 believers out of 20,000. Salar people, I know of 3 or maybe a bit more out of 120,000. Are they reached? They're completely unreached. Do they need help from outside? Yes. Do they need cross-cultural effort? Yes. So we need to assist the people, but also maybe even ourselves be cross-culturally going into these groups. Now, here are the statistics. The Joshua Project estimates there are 16,560 peoples by country in the world. When I say peoples by country, I mean you take into account the country that it's in. So the Kazakhs in China count as a different people group from the Kazakhs in Kazakhstan. And that's important because political boundaries, you could blame the Europeans, but the political boundaries now also create differences in culture. And so there are 16,560 of these groups. It's an estimate. It's not a perfect estimate, but it's an estimate. Now compare 16,560 people groups with 195 countries. So the gospel going to the ends of the earth is not just looking at the percentage of Christians in each country. It's not giving us a real picture. The real picture is this: there are 16,560 peoples in the world. Out of these, an estimated 6,700 are unreached. Is that a high number or not? 6,700 are unreached. And that accounts for 3.1 billion people, or 42% of the world's population. Isn't that incredible? I think a lot of people think we don't need to do missions anymore. Like, you sort of, you know, it's like, look, Christianity is all over the world. Christianity is all over the world, but is it reaching these places? Not all the time. 4 in 10 people in the world are not in an ethnic people group or a group that has adequate opportunity to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. Does that make us think? Should we be, as Christians, should we be going, okay, great, let's relax and just enjoy the blessing God's given to us? No, we shouldn't. Wherever these people are geographically, they're the unreached peoples of the world. And actually, they may be nearer Jerusalem. They're probably not a lot nearer Jerusalem than New Zealand is. Actually, many of these people are in what we call the 1040 window, which is basically from West Africa all the way along Middle East, India, China, places like that. So it's not geographically how far they are from Jerusalem that counts as the ends of the earth. It's how unreached, how untouched they are with the gospel. And the challenge of the church today, as well as focusing on our city where we start, our region, cross-cultural ministry within our area even, are we also focusing on the least reached people, the people with least access to the gospel in the whole world? God's heart has always been for mission. It still is. Ever since Genesis 12, when he called Abraham, he said, I'm going to bless you, and through you, all nations will be blessed. And he sent Jesus to bless Abraham's seed, Jesus, to bless the nations. And after Jesus' great mission was complete, on the first resurrection Sunday, Jesus breathed on his disciples. He said, receive the Holy Spirit. As the Father sent me, so I'm sending you. As the Father sent me, so I'm sending you. Are we willing, individually, and as a church, and as churches corporately, are we willing to follow Jesus? Are we willing to pray for, support, and be involved in mission to the very ends of the earth? Because that's what God's heart is. That's what God's into. He's into pouring into us that we pour out. So I hope that's given you some food for thought about the scope of mission today and these four particular areas. Firstly, Jerusalem, local ministry. This means being involved in reaching Auckland residents for Jesus and also the many who come to Auckland for a short or long time from all over the world. Secondly, Judea, regional ministry. For the churches in Auckland to act as a channel for the gospel to spread out to the towns and villages in the region, and particularly perhaps the average white Kiwi who doesn't know anything about the gospel. Samaritan, cross-cultural ministry, ministry to the many migrant communities and groups from all over the world and represented in this city and region. And finally, the ends of the earth, to be a part of reaching those thousands of people groups still largely untouched by the gospel. And as I close, I want to make one final point. I've talked about four different aspects or scope in the scope of mission. And I believe none of these four contradicts each other. What do I mean? I mean, often you hear people saying, oh, there's so much work to do here, we haven't got the resources to go over there. But I believe that actually misunderstands, that's actually the human view of economy. That's good human business planning and economics. Or have a certain, in economics, we talk about scarcity of resources. So you have a certain amount of resources, I can allocate them here, I can allocate them there. That's good business planning, that's good worldly wisdom. It's not remotely how God works. God's kingdom economics is the opposite. I believe the principle of the kingdom is multiplication. The principle of the kingdom is the more love you give out, the more space is there to put in. So I believe as we pour out people, resources, money, time, give it all away. As we give it away, God pours it in. If we keep it in, there's no space for more to come in. And I believe one of the keys to revival, to the flagging Western church, is just to be giving stuff away more. Give our best people away to the mission field, and God will raise up more people. If we keep the people, there's not much room for growth. If we give them away, God will give us more. Bless our resort. God has blessed the West so much. Now, let's just keep pouring this out. As we pour this out, I believe, I passionately believe, if we get more excited about world mission and giving away to the ends of the earth, I passionately believe God will raise up more people here than we had before. All the way from Abel, who gave his best. Remember Abel? He gave the best of his sacrifice. All the way to Jesus, who gave everything to win a bride. That's the biblical principle, multiplication. Keep pouring it out, and God pours it in. So I want to finish with that. As we pour out to local, regional, cross-cultural and global, God's going to pour into all of them, and all of them are going to grow. And as we go out to whatever, okay, so let us as individuals and churches be willing to follow the Great Commission. Let's follow Jesus. He told us to do it. He told us to go to all the ethne of the world. Let's do it. Let's fill Jerusalem with our teaching. Let's reach the highways and byways of Judea. Let's make risk-taking cross-cultural ventures into Samaria. And let's be involved in reaching the uttermost ends of the earth. And as we go out to whatever our calling is particularly, we can be sure that like in Acts, as we saw, God's purposes will prevail. He is with us. And we can go out with confidence. Because at the end of Jesus' great commission in Matthew 28, what does he say? Surely, I will be with you always to the very end of the age. Amen.